We're going to say some strong, strong things today. And sometimes when we hear a new truth, something we haven't been taught, and remember that you have been taught just enough for survival. That's how you got this far. Survival and a truckload of mercy. That's how you made it. You hadn't made it on your genius. How many know people right now in your life that the only way they've made it is through everybody else's mercy? Now look in the mirror and you see another one. We have only made it on sheer mercy. What little information we have, we've had enough information to not get in a car accident, or enough information not to destroy good relationships. But learning is the secret to life. Learning creates energy. God created us to be learners. Psalms 117, learn to do well. I'm going to talk about seven success systems. Systems that work for you, whether you feel it or not. Systems that create an outcome, a desired outcome. And success is the obtaining of a worthwhile goal. Success is the obtaining of a worthwhile goal. And I'm going to walk you through these are supposed to be on and ready for me, and I'm just going to probably have to let me take the time to set this, because I really need a little bit more time to set up. Success is the obtaining of a worthwhile goal. So you already have a lot of successes to your life. If you wanted to have a great birthday party and you've planned it all out and it happened the way you wanted it, you had a success. You had a success. I want to talk to you today about documenting information, because you need to keep information machines around you so that you can keep your mind free for creativity. Success is obtaining something you want. You saw a house, you wanted to live in it. I love that house. I want that house. Now, every pleasure has a price, and every pleasure has a season. There's pleasures that last 2 minutes, 1 minute, 1 day, 3 days, 1 month. Every pleasure has a price, and every pleasure has a season. Every pleasure has a price, and every pleasure has a season, how long it lasts. You've heard the saying, you get what you pay for. You never get what you pay for. Never. You'll get more or you'll get less. The price does not indicate the value. The price does not indicate the value. That's an illusion. You see a dress and they say, that's $400. Wow, must be a nice dress. Not necessarily. The price was determined by their hope. Could we find someone ignorant enough to pay this much money for this? And they usually do. When they can't, they have a special for their special customers, and you'll get a midnight email saying, because you were a fool for the last 12 months, we've decided to do something good for you. We're going to mark this price half, this dress half price. Till midnight. And you rush down there and you buy the dress that nobody else would buy. How many understand this? Six. Well, I'm halfway to Jesus level now, aren't I? What do you think success is? To you, what is success? What do you think is success? Praise God, Jesus loving me. If that's the case, Jesus loving you is success, then nobody fails. The whole world's a success since he loved everybody. That's not a good answer, is it? Success is, I think success is joy. And the level of your joy indicates the level of your success. I feel like joy is a great way to measure your personal progress. Not how big my house is. Do I have two houses? Do I have three houses? Do I have one suit? Do I have two suits? Your definition of success, and I'm talking to you like a family, because my goal is to narrow and narrow and narrow down my ministry until I'm only talking to people who can receive. That's my goal. We're going to shrink everything, and I've told you there on the internet, and I'm so sorry I didn't get a chance to tweet today, but I was going to be teaching. I've just been busy with special guests, and I haven't had any free moments whatsoever. But I will ask you that are watching there at your house, if you will, call two people right now. That will help us tremendously to get the word out. So wherever you are, if you'll call two people, is it button 15? 15E? A, button A? Oh, that's a first, okay. It's been E, it's been F, it's been 24. You have to be genius to find our teaching on our website. It's called A Holy Ghost Maze. Is it really A? Who would check that? Narisha, I will trust your follow through, your Monica. If y'all let me know where it really is on. I want to massage this afternoon into you where you have an understanding of life and the tracks and the roads and the highways. You need to understand that all your failures are pretty easy to understand. Once you understand, you see a failure, I can talk to you 5 minutes and tell you what your biggest problems will be. I can talk to you 5 minutes and see if you know it all and you think you know more than everybody you meet, so you never ask any questions. I can talk to you and see if you're a whine box, if you just whine about everything. Just whine. Whiners can't hide. Half of their joy is being able to whine. And they don't even realize what it is. It's a sound to them that's comforting. Success is a personal defined posture. Success is an experience. It's not a destination. It's not a place. It is an experience. Success is an experience, and you can have many successes. I remember when I bought one of my iPhones. I love this. I like this. Ooh, I like this. I like this. And then I remember when I saw another one, an Android. Oh, I really like that. I can dictate straight into Evernote on this. Wow, I can customize it. I like this. Remember when I found the glasses that were my size, 2.0. I like that. Life is a journey. Success is an experience. And the purpose of wisdom is to be able to see difference so you can perpetually live pleasured. Constantly have successes. You want a lot of successes. If you're going to lose 50 pounds, every time you lost a pound, you had a success. But if you say, all I need to lose is a half pound, now you've lowered it. You've made success closer and easier. That's why I tell people, I wouldn't set huge goals. I'd set goals you could taste quickly. I don't want to wait 3 years for joy. This is my 10-year goal. Wow, meanwhile, I could have made suicide last. No, you want goals close enough to enjoy. Taste quickly, taste fast. And I wouldn't worry about the bigness of a goal. I spent my whole life thinking that how big a goal was decided its joy. The size of your goal does not reflect the size of the joy. That's the case. We all need to marry about a 400-pound friend. Thanks, son. Praise God. Remind me to talk to you about this. This really is not Sunday morning worship. It's a school of wisdom. It's like a protege talk on Sunday afternoons that I do on button 24. So if you'll remind me, I'll write that. What is success to you? What is success to you. We're going to talk about territorial management. There is a domain for you. There is a turf where you should raise up to its highest level of excellence. You're going to have to decide what success is to you right now. What is success to you? Is it the owning of something? Is it the experiencing of something? Is it a relationship? I often tell the story about how I wanted horses so bad and growing up. And then I got to a place where I wanted a limousine. And I walk people, if you've ever heard the story, it's kind of funny. I wanted a limousine, really wanted a limousine. And I wanted it again the other night. Hokabed here? Where is she? Hokabed's what, 16 years old, and she had her first home coming in, and no limousine. She was going to drive herself to her own little party. And I was just sick of that. How baby, 16 years old. So I was trying to find, turned to one of my people. I said, find a limousine. Tell them I give them $100 for 1 hour. I don't need them 5 hours. I need them 1 hour. And she's all dressed up. She's so good looking. And she just, and she had a new dress on. She's just a good looking kid. And this was the first time. This was it. And our sister Vita was, you know, getting her stuff ready, getting her hair ready. And she's going to drive herself. Sort of like making your own birthday cake, you know. And so I wanted a limousine, and I got to thinking about the limousine, because we tried to buy a limousine. There's nothing spectacular about a limousine. They take a car and they cut it in two, and then they add 2 feet in between the two pieces, and that's a limousine. But to the human mind, limousine means class. Ooh. Every time we see a limousine, we try to see who's in there. Must be somebody important. No, it's just somebody with long legs, and they needed a. And nowadays they call a limousine, they call that a stretch limousine. I got to tell you this. Let me give you an example. Like Thursday, we went to Tulsa. I get in a jet feeling like a million-dollar man, you know. And I fly. I said, boy, this is good. Have you on air taxi? You just feel good, you know, on your jet. You just sort of kind of feel special. Guess what picked me up? A taxi with bents and dents all over it. I told Eric, I said, take a picture of every one of these dents. I want to remember this. And they had the name, their phone number all over the taxi. It's like your little girl when she finds makeup. And I sit there, I said, I'm not believing this. I get out of a jet, feel like $1 million. There's nothing wrong with the taxi if you're expecting it. I said, well, and I talked to her. She said, well, they said it was a limo. I said, honey, they said it was this. They said it was that. I said, next time you get a picture of it. They have to send you a picture of it. It doesn't match the picture. There's nothing wrong. I don't mind taxis. If you know, you're going to ride in a circus taxi. And I was thinking about the first time I always wanted to own a limousine. I'm coming, and here, the thing I want to deal with you today is what you think you're so excited about may not be exciting an hour afterwards. How many understand that? That the pleasure is mental. All the pleasure is mental. You sell yourself on how something's going to be. And I was all good about it, and I bought a limousine. Oh man, have a drive, just drive you around. Oh man, nobody explained to me that now you have to pay for the lunch of the chauffeur. You've got to have a chauffeur with you, because it's no fun driving yourself around in your own limousine. So you find yourself eating and your chauffeur's out there starving, and you feel like, my Lord, it's like leaving your dog in the heat. And the police comes up and puts you in prison. Now here's, you can, so you bring your, no more, this limousine, No more privacy now. None. So you bring your chauffeur in. He sits there, and he sits there at the table with you and hears every private conversation you have with everybody. And then he gets inspired, and you got a $40 meal there. And when you finally get home, it dawns on you that all the windows were tinted, so nobody got to know it was you. So the whole limousine thing was an inside job. Isn't this special? Isn't this wonderful? I'm in a limo. Now, if you ride very many limos, it dawns on you that it's only a two-seater. Every limo is only a two-seater. Everybody else has to sit sideways and look out the window, and it's like going through life like this. I could tell you so. I sold my limousine and took the money and bought four horses, not knowing you have to buy four shovels when you buy four horses. Somewhere I had Clint Eastwood and Lone Ranger on my mind, and for some reason I thought if you owned a horse, I don't know where I got that it was fun. I have no idea. But I was under the impression they were. I didn't realize you had to watch your head, because if one of them jerked their head, you could have a broken jaw like that. They could step on your foot and you hurt for days. How many's ever owned a horse? How many's ever wanted to own a horse? It's better to want one. Oh, I could tell you about wanting to show off. I had one that looked like Trigger. You know, Roy Rogers, and I knew Roy and Dale Evans, and so years ago, and so that was big. You know, Roy Rogers, Dale, they were like big heroes in TV kind of stuff, and God, they were Christian people, wonderful people. But so I had a horse that looked just like Trigger, and wanted to show off. Walked over there to my wonderful Trigger, and if he didn't turn around and bite me in front of all my friends, it's like having a wife that jumps on you in front of your friends. My goal was a reaction, and I got it. There. I sold my horses, took the money, and bought a monkey. Why? I love monkeys. That's where you stand at the zoo. You don't go to the zoo and just sit there for hours looking at birds. You watch monkeys. Gabriella, oh, I wish I could have you do your monkey imitation. She's got a monkey imitation that's worth watching. You just sit there and you laugh and you laugh and you laugh when she does her monkey imitation. You ever owned a monkey? You change its diaper every 2 hours? I always tell everybody it's like having a baby, a child, with no hope of it growing up. Monkey's an experience. You can't turn your back. You can't turn your back for a second. A monkey can move faster than you can see. Now, what you love about a monkey is the way they cling to you and the importance you feel. When a monkey puts its arms around you and clings to you, you say, I'm needed, I'm needed. And it's a lot better feeling than watching TV and the people that are starving overseas. So when you suddenly have a monkey that's just holding on to you, I love you, I love you. Oh, man, this monkey loves me. And out of the clear blue, the monkey may just go, pow, and hit you right in the face. It's a built-in insanity system. A monkey is a built-in insanity system. You have no idea what it'll do next. Sold my monkey. Took the same money. Let me just throw something out at you. Did you know you can have a lot of experiences on the same money? Do you realize you don't have to accumulate? Do you keep all the gum you ever chewed? It is possible to have many experiences on the same money. Buy something, don't like it, you sell it, create another experience. All the same money. Same money. The same money. I didn't have to have a lot of money. I had enough money to buy a limo. Then I had enough money to buy horses. Then I sold it and had enough money to buy monkeys. And then I bought a zebra. And you know my story about the zebra. They're insane. Now, inside of me, I like the look of a zebra. You ever gone through a travel book? You ever gone through a travel book? Wow. They just jump out. Zebra. A zebra. I had camels. I had 25 peacocks. About 16, 20 emus, which are like ostriches. And I had a lion, all those kinds of, you know about my love for animals. So I had all that, but I didn't have a zebra. I checked out giraffes. Building has to be too high. I checked out elephants, because don't you feel loved? Don't you feel like a big old elephant just kind of likes you? You don't know why, but when you see an elephant, you don't think of being set on by the elephant, do you? You think the elephant says, hi, let me pick you up where you want to go. Came in one morning. I'd flown all night from Los Angeles. And I drive to my house. There's my gates. I've been there almost 30 years and I'm in my same house. And I'm just walking around my yard. It's about 6 o'clock, 6:15. And I'm feeling kind of proud of me. Look what I have created. My word. Look what I've got. Got a lion over there. Got peacocks. Got camels. Got llamas. And now, across the yard, there is my wonderful zebra. Good. This kind of makes it. This is me. This is me. I've created my own little Garden of Eden. And about that time, my zebra sees me. I had not been around the zebra. It sort of happened while I was away for a few days. So to me, it was just part of the landscape. And the zebra made a headline for me. I mean, a real, real headline for me. And my eyes burning and glazed. And I barely got through my gate outside and closed the gate just in time not to be attacked. Now, I'm standing outside my gates. The zebra, and I didn't name the zebra, didn't love it long enough to give it a name. And the zebra began to claw and claw and claw, trying to get through the gate. And I'm sitting there thinking, this is kind of nutty, isn't it? I bought this zebra. This zebra's supposed to bring me pleasure. This is supposed to feel good. I'm supposed to like this. This is supposed to be a fun time I'm having. This is enjoyable. What's crazy? For me to get the zebra, I finally ran it with friends and boards. I've had every attacked man out of me. It was an attack. And I can tell you many things about camels sitting on other camels and llamas sitting on other llamas and killing them. And, I mean, it's just as if you think there's just peace in the animal kingdom, you have no idea. If you think it's bad being a human, wait till you're an animal. I tweeted the other day, pursuit is not the proof of love. And then I had a picture of a lion chasing a gazelle. Are you with me? I sold the zebra to two cowboys here in Fort Worth. They called me a week later and said, he's almost killed two of our people. I said, I know, that's why I sold him. He did almost kill me too. I said all that to say your pleasures will change. Your joy will change. What you love on Monday, you'll hate by Tuesday. And once you begin to assess your desires and realize they're your children, they're not your taskmasters, don't let a desire tell you who you are. A desire is just that. It's a desire. It's one of your kids. It's not you. Your desires are not you. Your mind is not you. I've desired things wrong. That didn't make it me. I remember the first time I ever got off in a Passover in casino in Las Vegas. And in Las Vegas, they have, what do they call these? What do they call them? Some of you are scared I'm going to tell on you. There's no cameras on you. You're not going to tell. Slumishly. Thank you, Pastor Daryl Yarbrough. He explained what they were over here. A slot machine. I know the one arm bandy. A slot machine. And so I've got a couple of hours between flights, and I'm looking there. I said, you know what a testimony this would be? If I put a quarter in and got back, you know, $50,000, I could tell everybody how God, and I can find scripture how he lays up the wealth of the wicked. See, I knew you knew that scripture. So inside me, there's this, all this, you know, I could do this. Maybe I could do this and make, what a testimony. And I'd be a gambler. A gambler is a person who has misplaced hope. All of Las Vegas was built by losers. All that money there, you see, that's folks who had it. They brought it to Las Vegas, and now they went back home without houses, without cars, without clothes, without watches. Las Vegas is a beautiful, beautiful showing you how losers and lose everything. One of the most fun cities, gorgeous cities that you'd ever want to see. A lot of people there crying, a lot of people upset, been through there, because it's built by people who did the slot machine. If you're not careful, you'll think this desire to play it is you. That's not you. You're going to have 1,000 desires come through your life. 1,000 desires going to come through your life. And you must make that desire a child. It's not your master. You don't work for a desire. Desire works for you. I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3. Every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the Word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the Tent Factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now, plant your seed of 300, and watch God move.
You don't work for a desire.
desire works for you. And once you realize that the thing you're so excited about Tuesday night, Thursday you no longer have the joy of it. And once you begin to understand that, my desires can change. Now this is why we're so fascinated with the Holy Spirit. This is why we're so fascinated by the Bible. Falling in love with Him never changed. In fact, the more you know Him, the better you feel about your investment. There's some things you do and you wonder, I hope I did the right thing. I hope I did the right thing. I hope I did the right thing. Not with God. Every day in His presence, you say, "Woo! How have I done without Him? How have I lived without Him? Wow, He's more than I ever anticipated." Whole different experience. And remember that we live from experience to experience. We're obsessed with experiences. To me, that's the purpose of money, is to create experiences. What is success to you? What is success to you right now? Take a sheet of paper, and you there at your house, I want you to take a sheet of paper, and I'd like for you to write down 10 things that to you would verify you have had a successful life. What do you think has to happen in your life for you to be a success? One of my 10 is to be healthy. I think health is life's first prize. One of my top 10 is household salvation, that everybody related and connected to me would fall in love with Jesus and never have the loss of eternity. To me, success would be a debt-free life, because anybody can borrow money. But to me, success would have a debt-free life. So when you woke up every day, you didn't have to go to work so you could live and stay in the same bed that night. You realize how many people work 16 hours a day so they could spend the night in the same bed? To me, a successful life would be lose 40 more pounds. Yep, 40 more pounds. That's for me. Now, I see skinny people unhappy too. But for me, and I actually have seen fat, huge people with a lot more joy than I do. So somewhere I know that weight loss doesn't make you feel heavenly. I mean, you understand what I'm saying. You understand what I'm saying? But I don't want to be overweight. I don't want to be overweight, and I'm learning. That's where I'm trying to create a health system that I don't want to be overweight. It kind of takes away from your testimony. I don't think overweight is a character system. It's not a character. Yeah, I heard a man, was it somebody? Somebody was saying one time, did you know that being overweight shows you have a character problem? I said, wow, Osama bin Laden must have been Jesus Jr. He was so skinny. No, I don't think your weight is proof that you're spiritual or not spiritual. And if we get to heaven and find out Jesus is about 100 pounds overweight, you and I are going to have a problem, aren't we? We're going to have a problem. But you are cultivating and you are sculpturing what you consider success is for you. I'm very interested in people being successful based on their joy, what they consider joy. And to me, that's the calling of wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, the ability to anticipate a consequence. Wisdom is the ability to use a scriptural reaction to a human problem. Now, I'll walk you through that shortly, but I want to massage this in the spirit, because I may not be able to teach you on this for a good while. And I want you to see the basics. What is success to me? Write it down. What's the top 10 things? What's the top 10 things would it take for you to believe you were successful? Now, if you're going through a breakup right now in a marriage or a boyfriend, girlfriend, you would say, I'll tell you, success to me would be the restoration of love and him to love me again and her to love me again. That's okay. Put that down. It's connected to you. It's whatever's connected to you. What do you think success is to you? Write the vision 46 times. The Holy Spirit told us in the Bible to become writers. Write about what you see, write about where you've been, and write about your future. Write. God's a writer. He's an author, and he instructed us to be a writer. What you see, 80% you remember, only 20% of what you hear. Write down your goals. What to you would be an exciting life of success? It may be all my children serve the Lord. Write it down. Now, if you wrote down not be lonely, that's not a goal. That's an objective. You can't measure that. If you wrote down I want to be a better Christian, that's not a goal. A goal is something you can measure. Something you can measure, because you can't tell when you're a better Christian. Does that mean you laugh longer? You laugh 14 times instead of 3 times that day. You can't measure your depth as a Christian. But if you wrote down, I would like to have a Bible habit of reading 3 chapters a day in the Bible. Now there, that's something you can go. That's something you can measure. Write down your goals. Now number them. And the 3 that excite you the most right now, the 3 that create the most energy in you right now, circle 3 times the number. If you've written down 10 things and numbers 1, 4, and 7 excite you the most more than any of the others, then circle those 3. Read your passions. It's one of the ways God talks. God talks to you through desires and passion. It took me 12 months to write the book Dream Seeds because I was going through a harrowing experience in a relationship at the time. And it was up and down. But I wrote Law of Recognition in 17 hours laying on the floor in prayer. I've written some books in one night and others take me 6 months because passion is a force for creativity. Passion is a path. One day of passion will produce more rewards than 1,000 days without passion. This is why I talk to you about your inspiration. I'm going to talk to you this in a few moments about your celebration system. How do you celebrate? How do you inspire yourself? Because nobody else has thought about you all day in a wonderful way. You have to think about your own inspiration. What excites you? What do you love? What excites you? What energizes you? I ask you to write down that list of goals. What are the top 10 things that if those 10 things happen, you would be a success? I remember when having a debt-free wisdom center was a goal. And then it happened and it was no more a goal. Your goals will change. Sometimes they're progressive. Sometimes they're contradictive. If you wrote down, I want a peaceful life, and then you wrote down number 3, I want 17 children. See, those are contradictory goals. So your goals need to be clear. They need to be perceptive. They need to be defined. What do you want? What do you like? What do you need? And they're goals for now. And your goals are based on perception, how you perceive something will be. I know if I do this, I could just know how what it's going to be like. You have your list? Have you circled the top 3? How powerful is a goal? An evil man with a goal is 1,000 times more powerful than a Christian without one. Even evil men have goals, and the goals work. Because God rules the earth through divine laws, and the laws work for the unbeliever too. How do you think 9/11 took place? Scriptural goals, the goal of focus. This one thing I do, my heart is fixed. The law of discretion, the law of relationship, the law of passion. Evil men right now have goals. Now, through the deception of predestination, Satan has managed to sabotage the goal-setting procedures of believers. We actually feel guilty for having goals. Oh, I don't know if God wants me to have this. I don't know. There's people, you won't believe, there's people play about IHOP. Should I have 2 pancakes or 3? Holy Spirit, should I have 2 or 3? Walnut syrup? what? We have massaged into the Christianity system that we feel like we are robots, and all we do is just go around, whatever you want, God, whatever. I have no desire, just whatever. If that's your will, that's your will. Something bad happens to us, God had a reason, God had a reason, God had a reason. So the average Christian does not set any distinctive goals. We hope, we gripe, and if something doesn't happen, God knew. How many has ever heard this? This is a popular thing. The reason God didn't give you any money, the reason you ain't got any money is God didn't think he could trust you with it. How many has ever heard that? Now there's you have stupid on a stick. Do you honestly think that God distributes money to people he can trust with money? So that you've got missionaries emptying their life for God, but they have no money, they have no wealth, they have nothing because God couldn't trust them. But all the evil men that own casinos and drug addicts, and there you got the cartels in Colombia, and you got the drug cartels in Juarez and Tijuana, God could trust them. He found somebody he could trust. Look at someone next to you and say, stupid people make me sick, so be very careful about me. Just look at them and say, stupid people make me sick, so be very careful around me. If everything that happens was planned by God, why is there an instruction to learn, to sit at his feet, be taught? What's the reward of wisdom? What's the loss of being stupid? Nothing. According to the word of God, wisdom is the principal thing. And all you're getting, get wisdom, get knowledge, understanding. Wealth is the product of wisdom. God doesn't even decide who has money. Wealth is not a divine decision, it's a divine desire. Wealth is the product of divine design, not design decisions. You saw my precious father today. They don't come a better man than him. Never sinned a day in his life. I haven't met a human as holy as my father. But he had no money. Why? He was taught, like most have been, that if God wants you to have it, he'll give it to you. If he doesn't, you don't have it. We never saw that goals, setting goals. Now, do I have to set a good goal to obtain it? The worthiness of a goal may have divine sponsorship, but it doesn't guarantee a divine outcome. You can have good goals and never achieve them, not knowing how to achieve the goal. What are your goals? How would I know your goals? If I looked at you, Sue, and said, how strong do you really feel about those goals? You'd probably say, very strong. Think about them all the time. And I'd say, Sue, I'm going to go to your house. Sue's one of my best partners. She's one of the most significant seed sowers in my whole life. But if I went to her house and I looked on her walls, I'd say, Sue, this is when you was a kid. This is pictures of everybody. Where's the pictures of your goals? What you want to obtain, what you want to have, what you want to do. Have you designated one wall, just one wall, just to your goals? Have you? And why not? Why not? Well, brother, my God knows my heart. That ought to scare you to death. The whole point of having goals is to correct your vocabulary. The purpose of having goals is to overcome painful past. Without a goal, yesterday will become a constant experience in your mind. If you don't have a future, you'll build your life around yesterday. The only cure for a painful experience of the past is to get a picture of your future. God talks in pictures. Abraham, see the stars? That's what your kid's going to be like. I won't replay all of this, except most of you know about the Harvard University test that they did on a 10-year from 1950. And 10 years later, they did a test on all the graduates, and they were shocked to find that 3% of the graduates of 1950, 10 years later, had more money than all the 97% left. They had accomplished more than all the other 97% left. 3% of the graduating class. And when they looked for a common denominator, they had the same teachers, they had the same education, they had the same knowledge. The only difference between the 3% and the 97 was the 3% had written down their goals and put them in front of them. When I drove out of the hotel Thursday night in Tulsa, I remembered the young man who was a hotel clerk. If I recall, he was a bellman. And he had a picture under the glass. And every day he looked at that hotel and said, "Something's the world's most famous hotel at the time." He said, "Someday I will own that hotel. Someday I will own that hotel. Someday I will own that hotel." His name was Conrad Hilton. What is your goal? And you won't succeed until the goal has you. It'll never be enough to have a goal. The goal must become an obsession, because you only succeed with an obsession. If I say, "Come up here, I want to find people to have a job," because I don't think there's anything to find a job. I think anybody in the world can find a job. Everywhere there's a problem, there's a job. Everywhere there's a job, there's a future. That's all a job is problem solving. You find a problem to solve. Everywhere there's a job, there's potential for favor. And everywhere there's favor, there's honor. And everywhere there's honor, there's money. Money is packed in every nook and cranny of the universe. Nothing on earth is more plentiful than money. Nothing. If you scratch your car, somebody makes money. You get thirsty, somebody makes money. If you break a glass, it's called attention getting. Works. Even made you look, didn't it, Pastor? It's purposeful. Even when there's a problem in the world. Boy, I got your attention. You don't have to have the anointing. Just throw a glass. You got the attention there. Everywhere there's a problem. Don't look so worried, Laura. It'll be picked up. We'll get another glass, and it'll work. Everywhere there's a problem, there's money. There's money. I'm not asking for it to be picked up now either, if anybody's getting excited about it. Everywhere there is a problem, there is money. This is a problem I want you to think about. Everywhere you see a problem, there is money. If you become accustomed to looking for problems, you have invitations to honor, to favor, to blessing, to prosperity. When you become conscious of problems, you see that the world is full of wealth, because all the money that's been here is still here. Act happy. If I go to Sue's house and I say, "Sue, I want to see your goals," I can't help you until you have a goal. God can't help you until he knows what you want. What do you want your life to be like? How soon are you going to move toward it? What's the cost of that goal? Every pleasure has a cost. What price are you willing to pay for that pleasure? Look good today. That orange and blue goes good, don't it? Hallelujah. Proud of him? Did you kiss him today yet? Twice? Was it memorable? You want to build your life around your goals. Sometimes there's daily goals. Remember when you wanted to write a book, but you've got books. Remember when, how long were you on television? 26 years? How long was you on television? How? 16 years in? 16 years. Remember when it was a goal? He said, I didn't want it, but the Lord wanted it. You set your goals and you build your life around them and you build your vocabulary around them and you say, this is what I want to accomplish. Do you have your book, baby? The Uncommon Girl? You have it handy? Did you put in your book an uncommon girl sets goals? I remember that page. And you're right. You put a goal of something you want to become, something you want to do, something you want to have. Your goals decide who you're willing to listen to. Your goals determine what you're willing to ignore. When you set a goal, now you know where to put your energy. If you set a goal to, you're a goal setter, aren't you, Brother Anthony? You're a goal setter. How many people you want to win to Christ during this time? Where are you heading? Are you fixing to go back overseas anywhere? You just come back? Zimbabwe. In January. Is it cost? Is it all free? It costs you money. It's a goal, isn't it? It's a goal. Son, when you set a goal, you expose who is disinterested in you. So if you go to your family and say, I'm needing $7,000 to go to Zimbabwe, and they say, praise God, we're going to pray for you. Now you know not to tell them about your next goal. But if you come and say, Dr. Murdock, do you have all your money you need for it? Okay. Have you started raising the funds yet? Okay. We'll give you $1,000. Make sure. Give him $1,000 because I believe in you. Now, your goal gave me a highway to become a part of your life. And that little $1,000 seed, Linnell, give it to him before he leaves today so he doesn't have to call back and said, just praying about your $1,000 that you had said you was going to send that never arrived. Your goals reveal who's loyal to you, who believes in you, who has confidence in you. Until you set goals, you don't even know who's a friend and who's not. You can't even tell who's for you and who's against you till you set a goal. You can waste half your time trying to figure out who likes you. You think a smile? Do you think a smile means I love you? A smile means don't you love me? Your goals. What's on your walls? What's on the walls of your house? How do you build today? What's one of your goals? One. To write a book a month. 32 page, 48 page? 32 page. So that's just talking to her really, really for 1 hour, isn't it? Isn't it? Is she enjoyable?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm sure there's one night a week that you're going to talk to her for 1 hour on something. One night a week, right? You have a love night that you just talk to her about your goals and dreams. Like, knowing you, you do it every day. I know. I know. I read about it every day. You got more goals than I do. A book a month. I'm saying all this to get you goal-oriented, to think of success. What do I think success is? Now let me give you the seven systems you're going to need. Number one, you're going to need an information system. You're going to need an information system. Where are you going to gather all your knowledge? Where are you going to put it? Writing is the slowest way to document information. I keep recorders with me. A lot of people think these are phones because we call them phones, but that's only one of 200 things they will do. Why would I hire a secretary to type for me if I can sit right there and when I have an idea, just click and it types it out for me and puts it right in front of me? What is your information system? Where do you gather knowledge? Where do you gather information? If you see something in a store, say, oh, I love that. That's beautiful. I'd like to. You just pull out your little information system and go click and you got a picture of it. Oh, my sister would love that. So you go click and you put her in an email address and she gets it in 10 seconds. You're walking down the store and you suddenly see an incredible arrangement. Nancy, I think it was your daughter, wasn't it, that took pictures. Remember, I saw the gift. Target had a gift section with all the prettiest bags and gifts. Click, take picture, click. Now, what your wanting's already happened. Just take a picture of it, make it quick. Somebody's done what you want to do. Somebody's done what you want to do. How many, what's the price of Zimbabwe? How many thousands? 4,000, 3,000? Well, at 1,600 for a plane ticket? Okay, just make it 1,600 so we pay his plane ticket. And I'm going to pay that. Is that one way or two ways? Two ways. So now I want to tell you something. Let's hold off on the 1,600 until he has eight friends give him 200. Okay? You have eight friends? I hope so. Is that right? I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3. Every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the Word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the Tent Factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now. Plant your seed of 300 and watch God move.
Until he has eight friends give him 200.
Okay. You have eight friends? I hope so. Is that why you're going to Zimbabwe, make new friends? Because you don't have any here? You have any new friends? Now, I'm going to hold off on that for a reason. I'm going to make it a challenge, 1600. I know you got eight friends. You're a soul winner. People love you. I want you to call eight people you like and say, Mike Murdock just said if eight of my friends would give me $200 on Zimbabwe, he would pay the $200. Would you be one of the eight? Do you feel God leading you to be one too? If they say, I'll pray about it, say, oh, you don't have to. Let's pray right now. Don't ever tell us I'll pray about it later. I know those kind. Say, would you mind if I prayed something? I am asking God for eight people who love souls, who love the Word of God, who believe in me to help me in Zimbabwe. And Mike Murdock just told me if I had eight people who believed in me enough to plant a little $200 seed, he would equal their $200 and pay it to. That means, Bill, if you would plant a $200 seed in Zimbabwe today, Mike Murdock would give me $200 too. Would you be one of those eight? You have people who can do that? You don't have to work on it. You make them call. You call them. There's nothing to walk. There's nothing to work on. You call them. Write their names down right now. Just write their names down. Think. And the most likely person to plant the 200 is someone who did it last time. Now, it's called challenge seed, which now what you're going to do, you're going to call eight friends, and I hope you do it by 10 o'clock tonight because this thing's from the Lord. You can call eight people and say, you won't believe what Mike Murdock just told me. He said, if I had eight friends who would plant $200 seed, he would equal it. He would pay it too. Would you be one of my eight? Don't have to have it for another 7 days. And they stuttered around and said, I know you would. You would if you had it, wouldn't you? Yeah, oh, let's pray right now. God will give it to you, okay? That's 3,200, right? That's enough to get started, right? So you know your bill's already, you know the ticket's already paid. We're paying it, okay? Now you need other money because you're probably going to want to eat during that time. You probably don't fast when you're preaching every day, do you? I didn't think you did. Okay, now, so you have a purpose here. You have a role. Do you follow me? What are we doing here? We've got a relationship system that's involved in our goals. What is wisdom? Wisdom is the ability to recognize
difference.
Say it loud.
Difference.
Okay. There is a difference in your freeloading people and the people who believe in you and who are sowing you. Now let's go back to your address book. Is your addresses in here? Okay. There's friends, and then there's VIPs. And then there's sponsors, and there's supporters, right? There's a difference. Don't treat everybody the same. There's people wanting to go to your funeral. There's people who would go, but they planned a picnic. Pick out your top 12 people. Write down your top 12 people. Just write down their names right now. I'll wait. Watch while you do it. My name's not even on there yet. My Lord, son. I thought. Dr. Mike Murdock. Yeah, Michael's okay. God knows me by both names. Is there some water? You want to undo that for me? Thanks. She planted your seed. Yeah, I got water. She reached over and got Carolyn's. Now, here's the point. Here's something you want to see. We've got to create an information system. Where do you store your knowledge? Where do you store what you need to know? And it must become retrievable. You have to be able to access your information within seconds. I like iPad. I like the Android systems, but you need an information system. What is your information system? If you keep a journal, that's fine. It's fine. What happens when it burns? What happens when somebody steals it? Now, let's say you keep journals. Paula White was here some months ago, and she said, Mike, I've got hundreds of journals. I said, right. Now, suppose you wrote something about time management. Say that again.
Where would you find it?
Well, she's a prophetess. That's exactly what I was going to say. Where would she find it? She can't. She may have said something in 1983 that was profound, but she can't retrieve it. Information that's not retrievable is not usable. You have an iPad? You want one? How do you feel about not having one? You need an information system. You need a place to store knowledge and store information. You must become information oriented. Where will I store? Now there's your relationship system. Where do you put your names and addresses, and how do you know the difference? If you meet somebody that says, by the way, if you ever need any carpet put in your house, I'll do it for free. What are you going to do? You're going to try to remember their name? You're not going to remember it 3 years from now. So you just go to your little information system. You put carpet friend, put their name. So when you want carpet, you just come go to the C's in your little address book. There's carpet. That's a good one. You're smart. Huh? I see that. You're smart. You're smart. You cultivate an information system. It becomes a relationship system. If your car breaks down, who do you call? Somebody. You have AAA. You have a list of the top three people in case something happens. You have vendors. Somebody you do business with, so you keep a vendor list. A vendor list. If your roof leaks, what do? Go through an encyclopedia? No. Call us. And if he has an address card, you can take a little picture of that address card. Let's just do it while we're thinking about it. I'll take one too because I do have a roof leaks. And there is a system here. You just take a picture of that, and guess what? Your Evernote program will retrieve every word on there. You do know that, right? Evernote. You do know that if you take a picture of that, 2 years from now, you can recall any word that's in that picture and pull it up. Just to give an example. The other night, somebody asked me, what is the Villa code for my environment? I can't remember all those things. So I just go to Evernote, click code, and up comes all my codes. You are one click away from pleasure. I bet that becomes an advertisement thing. Got a few more minutes to go? Okay. Let's work on your information system. You have an iPad? I won't say anything, Pastor. I would never say one word about having a wife that had no iPad. I wouldn't kiss him for several hours until you talked to him about an iPad. I wouldn't kiss him, period. But, I mean, for you, I would. He's sitting here. He's right. He's trying to make you. Oh, maybe you don't like information, though. You don't like iPads. You don't like being able to do all that kind of stuff, do you? I just ask a question. No wonder she didn't have an iPad. She's never really wanted one, has she? I'm joking with her, folks, because she can handle it. The point is, you want to really build your information system. How do I work with my information system? What am I needing? What I want in my system? Well, one thing, you want a notebook. Let me give you an example. You see this right here? I can take a picture of that, and instantly it will be in 6 different computers and 5 different phones. Why do you have 5 phones? Well, maybe I have more friends than you do. And the whole point is that you want to be able to retrieve that information. Did you know if Prophet Marquez took the picture of this, it would be in his phone? In 5 seconds, it would be in his computer. It would be in his Apple. Is this Apple 1 or 2? How you feel about having a... Now, he can take a picture of me, if you had a number 2, and you could take a picture of me and send it to anybody in the world, anywhere he wants. He could take a picture of what, and say, this is what's happening right now. Do you have an information system? Has anybody ever talked to you about it? Nada. No, nada. No. Where did I get nada? That's D nada. It's nothing. I did nothing. Nothing means nothing. Oh, new Spanish phrase. Nothing means nothing. Are you creating wisdom keys here? Here's the... How do you say no in Spanish? No. Thank you, brother. And I could tell Brother Kelly really wanted to help me on my glass. He's scared to death. Nobody can concentrate thinking I'm fixing to walk on glass. No, we all walk on water. We don't walk on glass, do we? You want to, Brother Kelly, you can help me now on this glass over here. I know you was really wanting to. And I could see Laura over here. She's gotten some gray hairs since I threw that glass. Now, what is your relationship system? Do you have one? Do you have a list of vendors and the people who work if you have a problem? Have you named the top 10 problems you normally have and the 10 people you'd call instantly if something happened? Where do you store your secrets? All your secret codes and passwords, where do you store them? Not in your head, hopefully. What if you had a headache? Now they're all messed up. So you have a place where you store your knowledge and your information. I can tell I'm boring some of you. This is, to me, is fascinating because no one ever told me about an information system. Nobody ever told me that. Pastor Davis, nobody ever told me I needed an information system. There's one more here. Now, let me ask you another question. How do you manage your task? Write this down. I am exchange. I am exchange. It's a little application for your phones. It makes a task easy to document. If I have a task for Evita, let's just say somebody comes up and Evita handles all my personal correspondence. She's the one that when I need somebody, I go through her for most things that I won't repeat it because she's an accuracy addict. She is just accuracy. She never misses a word. Never, never. Always exactly on it. So if I tell Evita, I said, Evita, such and such. You know what she does? She turns on her iPad and just sits there and talks because she knows that talking is 5 times faster than writing. Now, in an Android system, which is a little different than an iPad, everywhere you can type, you could talk it instead, and it would type for you. Why would I go through my life? Why would I... You'd have to be half parrot to enjoy texting. God, what you doing? I'm texting. You a Texan, huh? No, I'm texting. Now, get this and get it through. There has to be a system where you document tasks, when to do it, who's going to do it, and who needs a copy of that task. So she dictates, and she goes, boing, and it goes to Lalitha or someone else who needs it. She's got a copy. I've got a copy. And in all of her electronics, see, electronics is an information system. It's a world where you can gather information and distribute it quickly. Now, why is time so important? It's the only currency you can exchange for anything else you want. God didn't give some people 26 hours, other people gave 20. He gave us all the same amount of time. When my bills became $18 million a year, I realized there's 52 weeks in a year. 2 weeks for vacation leaves 50 weeks. 50 weeks times 40 working hours a week is 2,000 working hours a year. Now just think for a moment. You're a walking system of 2,000 hours. But you have a goal. Let's say your goal is this, and it comes to 20,000 a year. You know with 2,000 hours, you got to make $10 an hour to get your $20,000. But you got a little higher goal. Wait, Brother Mike. I want to be able to make a house payment for $1,000, and I want to buy a car, and my bills are $40,000 a year. Okay, no problem. You got 2,000 hours to exchange, which means you got to make $20 an hour times 2,000 to get your $40,000 a year. For me to get my $18 million, I have to make $9,000 an hour. Now, does that mean I go to the corner and I sell pencils as quickly as possible? No. It means suddenly I look at my 40 hours a week. Where can I make the best decisions? Where can I make the best decisions? What are the opportunities available to me? Who has asked for help? Who needs help but won't ask for it? There's so many little keys here. What is your task management system? Nancy, you've got two boys and a girl. You have three things, and remember, you assign territories, not task. But let's just tell you, you tell your oldest son, son, your bedroom is your domain. Here's the eight things that you have to do. There's a list. I put them on the wall. And those eight things have to be done by 7:45 every morning. That's your domain. You've assigned that territory to him. Now, does he write everything down? No. There's a task management system. And you show him how to enter it. And he even has a little alarm so that if he has to do something at 4:30 in the afternoon, he just goes click, and at 4:15 it says, 15 minutes, you got to do this. Don't forget it. Never trust your mind. You ought to know that by now. Use your mind for creativity. Do you have a task management system? And a few months ago, I'm sitting there, and out of the clear blue, I think it was Brother Eric. Where's Eric? I said, Eric, you have that? Yes, sir, I've got it. I said, let me see your task management system. Well, it was deciphered. It was like in code. It was something only Eric would know. Kind of messy, wasn't it? Everybody's task system is a mess because they've never been taught how to manage their task. You've got to have it in front of you to remember it. You've got to, so your mind will be free. And it dawned on me, and this sounds so, I hate to admit it, I'm learning faster now than I've ever learned in my life. And what I'm learning is that most important things have never been taught yet. And it dawned on me, let me ask you something. Have you ever, I'll ask Brother Eleazar, he never gets mad at me. Have you ever told Miss Eva, remind me of that? Have you ever said something like that to her? Now, what have you just did? You dumped a burden on her. Hey, remind me. Don't forget that. She don't have enough raising the kids, does she? She don't have enough doing all the housework. Now he says, remind me. Remind me. Don't let me forget that. If you turn around to people, you'll find that nobody is using a task management system. And it's been established. There's a checklist. Let me give you an example. I like for an area to be prepped or prepared for me before I enter it. I don't want to go get in my van to go somewhere and someone say, we're out of gas. You want to get some gas? We're out. We want to get some gas? No, I feel a desire to use water today. I just feel an anointing for water. I don't want to hear that. You want anything to drink? Oh, no, I never drink. I haven't drank in 43 years. I hadn't drank. Of course I want something to drink. So there is an established checklist, which is called Check Pro, that you can have a checklist for the day every Friday. You can have a checklist what you do. And you've got enough children never to have to work the rest of your life. How many children you have? How many children? Jesus reached the world with just 12. So there is a little system called Check Pro, and that's a checklist. And the children can have their own checklist. It's always there. This is what you do at 8 o'clock. This is what you do at 8:15. This is what you do at 8:30. There's a checklist so you don't have to remind yourself. It's simple. But it's what it, all this is territorializing your world. You literally are creating a territory management. You're managing your territory. If you can't keep one car clean, why are you buying two? That's why he only gave us 2 ears. What if he'd given us 17? We'd have never had clean ears, wouldn't we? Do you have a task management system, Amy? You have a checklist? So if I want to go somewhere in the van, I want certain drinks. I want a Snapple, a Diet Snapple. I want ice water. I want this. And I want the music playing. And this is what I want. When I come home, I want a certain song sound in my... Why? You prepare an area for your living. What song excites you? Put that on the checklist. And out of the clear blue, it just hit me. I said, this is crazy. I've got 80, my bills are $10,000 an hour. My bills. I have 89 people on payroll, and I have never established a task management system. But for years, I said, write that down, Carolyn. Don't forget, write that down. Lord, don't forget that. Write that down. Have you written it down? Uh-huh. Where? Somewhere. I wrote down somewhere. And so she goes through her dresser drawers, and she finds 9,400 pieces of paper. She wrote it down, but she could, I'm just joking with you, but she couldn't retrieve it. She couldn't find it. Did you know if you can't manage your territory, God would be foolish to enlarge you? Can you manage your territory? Are you bringing your territory up to highest level of excellence? Everybody's wanting to buy this place next door where there's, you know, where the food ministry is, you know, that Shimon. I said, we can't even keep the wilderness center clean. Why would I buy more things to do? Let's raise our present turf to its highest level of excellence. Now I'm going to make fun of somebody. I won't tell you who they are, but I turned to someone recently, and I said, "Take a picture of that." And they said, "My phone doesn't take pictures." And I stopped. I said, let me get this straight. Let me get this straight. And they said to me, it costs more. You know, the monthly bill, it costs more. I said, how much more? $14 a month. I said, let me get this straight. You don't think the world is worth 50 cents a day. So you're not about to pay 50 cents for the capacity, the ability to take pictures of the whole world. A rainbow can come up, but it's not worth 50 cents. Your daughter has a baby. That's possible. The baby's ugly. Maybe you don't want a picture. But the ability to take that picture, this is called provoking. The ability to take the picture is there. Now to you, he may not be a good looking man. You may have married him because he knew Jesus. But there are times he's got some sizzle to him. And there's times, where's the towel? Somebody go and throw me a towel. Is there a towel? Is there a towel? Is there a towel? My Lord, $1 million. That's not a towel. And you teaching English? That's not a towel. That's not a towel. You know, okay. Remind me trying to train you on that. Let's just say, he comes out of the bathroom, and he's feeling, thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. And I won't keep it. I'll return it. He comes out of the bathroom. Now, there's a picture I have of myself like this, and it inspires me. It makes me remember when I was frisky. 65, you're not, but at that time I was. He comes out of the bathroom. And he looks at you with a certain look. It's a Holy Ghost look. But it's not a desire to pray. And something in you says, man, honey, I wish I had a picture of you just the way you look like that. Man. But you can't take a picture of him like that, can you? Why? Because you ain't got an iPad. You ain't got an iPad too. This person told me that the whole world didn't have enough beauty to invest $14 a month in it. The woman I was talking to was worth that. Just look, she was good looking. I'd have paid $14 for a picture, much less the camera. But in her mind, she was saving $14. Hallelujah. And couldn't take pictures of a talking pumpkin if God gave her a miracle. Imagine if God said, I'm going to give you a miracle and let a pumpkin talk to you. Thought of that being October. If there was a talking pumpkin, she could videotape it. Why? I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness. Difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day. On your iPod or your MP3, every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a hundredfold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the Word of God says in Malachi 3 that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the Tent Factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now. Plant your seed of 300 and watch God move. If there was a talking pumpkin, She couldn't videotape it. Why? Saving $14 a month, praise God. Celia, you got two gorgeous children. And neither one of them are stupid. That's an advantage. Because sometimes beautiful people don't have the advantage of a brain. But you've got two children that are really smart. But what if you was trying to save $14 on your phone? The kids could have beautiful experience, but you don't have any memories. You don't have any pictures. Now you don't have an inspiration system. When you get to dating boys, if he doesn't have a phone to take your picture, because someday you're going to be good looking. I just have a feeling someday, it won't be long, it won't be a few years, you'll be good looking. If I were you, I wouldn't even date a boy that didn't take your picture every day. Every day. We talk about an information system. We're talking about a task management system. We've talked about a celebration system where you have a table at your house where all the gifts come to, and you have your thank you notes established, because that's your celebration system. When something good happens, you go to your celebration table, and you, what is your inspiration system? How do you inspire you? How? There should be names in your telephone, because not everybody inspires you. There's people that love you that can't inspire you. There's people that don't even know you that can inspire you. What kind of inspiration system have you established for yourself? Are there sounds that you love to hear? You ever got to choose your ringtone on your phone? One goes, meow. Another one goes, Troy, Troy, Troy. And then you have another one. There's all kind of sounds. And then there's ones that's romantic. Aha. And you put that sound with somebody that inspires you. Now, ducks are popular in Louisiana. Pastor Holton used to kill little ducks. Had a real, was it a 12 gauge? What was it you used to murder little ducks? Well, was it a 12 gauge? I remember that, because you would never believe the spirit of an assassin is in a man of God. But he and my father would look for these beautiful ducks and blow them out of the air, and they would fall. And then Sister Jackie would make, you didn't cook them. Oh, praise God. You had a conscience in your house. You had a conscience in your home. Now, what inspires you? What excites you? I'm wanting to send Eva. There's a place called Charming Charlie's. Have you ever heard of it? Charming Charlie's. Have you ever heard of that place? Your daughter told you. Been wanting to do that for her. Remind me to give you some money. You'll go crazy in Charming Charlie's. It's got all kind of jewelry, turquoise, every kind of color, isn't it? Give her a sound of excitement about Charming Charlie. Woo! That's Charming Charlie's. You find what inspires you, and you put it in front of you. What is the system for you to inspire yourself? How do you inspire you? How? What are the sounds? What are the colors? Who are the people? Who are the people that when you talk, how many ever talked to somebody when you got off the phone, you just felt like, Jesus, come quickly, come quickly. You ever? Yeah. How many talk to other people that when you get off the phone, I can run through a troop or leap over a wall? How many have people in your life that after you talk to them, you suddenly are in a picnic mood? Nobody here. Wow, you have. I've been gone too long. Pastor Darrell, you've got to be a little more fun than this. Don't you have some sound, Brother Darrell? It may be Kristen looking over at you and say, come here, you hunk. I don't know the sounds. I don't know the sounds. But you've got to identify what inspires you. I have to keep myself inspired. I don't have anybody waking me up every day saying, how great thou art. I'm exhausted. I'm tired. And I can't go another step. And I feel like I've emptied my life. And all I hear is yang, 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 yang. I have to find out how to inspire me. I know I've taken up too much of your time. But if you'll give me 7 minutes, we'll be through. There are systems for success. There are songs that motivate you, that excite you. I like red, deep red and black dishes for Chinese food. The other day, someone brought me some popcorn. I like popcorn. But it was in a watermelon bowl. Do you know how confusing that is for me? You have any idea what my mind went through eating popcorn looking at a watermelon bowl? When I eat a hot dog, I want it in a hot dog bowl with a hot dog. When I eat Spanish food, I want some Spanish guitar. I want the sounds that make me want to kiss my own hand. Now, why am I telling you that? You have probably not invested 2 hours of your life identifying a system that will keep you motivated, keep you inspired. See, everything diminishes. Everything takes away your desire. I look at my belly and I just sit there and think, I've just got to remind me to wear black shirts the rest of my life so that nobody sees that belly. I see things I don't like. I hear things that demoralize me, discourage me. And don't worry about it. If you want an iPad, I'll get you one, okay? I'll get you one. Just think about it if you want one. As good as you are, you're one of my inspiration points. I walk in here and I see Kathy. If there's anything I want for you, it's for you to learn how to keep yourself inspired. And there's a system for it. There are certain sounds and certain pictures that when you see them, you're energized. You like that. Now watch. I'm going back there to host the Brazilian pastors. And I passed by the aquarium. Have you seen this aquarium on the end of the hall? Need to take pictures because they have searched over 212 countries to find the ugliest fish made. And they're in that aquarium. I'm 65. I've never seen fish that ugly in my lifetime. In my lifetime. And I'm walking down the hall and I'm fixing to go around and say, I paid $10,000 for that aquarium. I didn't pay $10,000 for ugly fish from the swamps of Katrina. And I turned around to somebody. Brother Ron, I don't know who it was. I said, tell Brother Ron. Because he'll Ron thing, because he'll change it. All those fish will be on somebody's platter in 24 hours. And he'll. Now, joke for those who are taking that seriously. At home, no, I'm not an assassin of little baby fish. They're just ugly. There's a place for ugly, but not in my aquarium. That company puts them in, right? There's a company puts them in. Fire them. I don't want them here another time. I don't want to see that truck or whoever they are. I want them out of my life. Anybody that can charge me that much money for ugly need to be ugly. I don't want to see those fish. They're ugly. I sat there and looked. I looked for something worth looking at in that aquarium. Now, why hasn't somebody changed it before? Because they're comfortable with ugly. Everybody's comfortable with ugly. Oh, that's why people marry who they marry. You wouldn't marry people that others would marry. There's people you see and their husband, wife, they boy, aren't they good looking? Not really. But to them they are. But that's an aquarium. I want some good looking fish. When I walk down that hall, I don't do it often, but when I walk down that, I want to see something I like. I've got a whole world thrusting things in front of me that I don't like. So I'm going to invest in finding what I do like. It's not that we're an unhappy people. We just never learned what inspired us. We've never learned what excited us. We've never learned how to... Do you have any clothes at your house that when you put them on, you feel sizzle? Amy's got clothes that, hey. And you've got clothes that you don't really, I told you about this, how God dealt with me about wearing t-shirts with holes in them. Walking through my house, because I was raised poor, when you're raised poor, you keep clothes for a lifetime. You do. When you're raised poor, you keep every t-shirt you had when you was 3 years old. Because you think you're getting ahead. Thank you, sir. You think you're getting ahead. Do you know how to inspire you? Are you investing in it? What is your system for inspiration? I happen to like little cases, briefcases. I like briefcases. I like the place to put this phone. There's a little case. And there's a place for this phone. And there's a place for this. And there's a place. I like things in order. And I've asked the Holy Spirit lately. I've asked Him, show me how to maintain order in my territory. Show me how to manage my turf. Sometimes you're so overwhelmed. We say, God, I want to trade in my palace, and I'm going to live. I've decided to live in a tent because I don't have to take care of everything. Lord, I'm willing to do without a bathtub because I'm tired of scrubbing it. How many understand what I'm saying? Wait, stop and say, you know what? I am going to excel in systems. I didn't get into the mentorship system, who you learn from. How do you learn the easiest? How can you learn the most? But every day I choose the top things I want to learn. And I put them on a huge wall, on a projector. And I look at them because there's so much I don't know. What if you live a whole lifetime and never learn how to unlock you? When I went to get Daddy's first manicure and pedicure, he was really touchy about that because he would never let us see him without a t-shirt. Daddy's very, very modest. I said, Daddy, I want you to have a pedicure. Oh, son, that's all right. I'm not into those things. Daddy, I want a young lady. He's 94, but he's not blind. I want a young lady to sit there and work on your nails. Another young lady is going to take care of you. Oh, so I said, Daddy, just one time. And we can stop it. You ever had a pedicure? Write that down. How old are you? 40 what? How old are you? How old are you? Almost a half a century, and he's never had a pedicure. This is called provocative teaching. Trying to provoke you. I got Daddy sitting there, and he looked at me, and he raised his eyes. And I'm thinking all kind of things, because I've done some bad things. Not real bad, but like when he was 80, I put him in Disneyland Hotel, the roller coaster. Oh, I know. I can't believe I did that. I tell you, he was praying in tongues. I got off. I thought he'd kill me. It hit me as we started rolling. I thought, this may not be good for an 80-year-old man. I thought I was going to give him a new experience. Wonderful new experience, Daddy. Well, he looks white. I mean, his whole face, I thought, my, what if he has a heart attack? I'm the cause. And Daddy looks over at me, and they start massaging his feet in hot water. And Carolyn, they put hot towels around his legs. And Daddy looked over me and says, pretty nice, isn't it? I said, I want you to find the systems that help you make progress, that help you be able to retrieve information. And every day you wake up saying, this is a day as a gift from the Lord. This is a good day. It will produce divine surprises, divine completions. This is a day I will discover how much somebody loves me that I did not know. This is a day I get to lavish love on somebody who wears red hats to church. This is a day I can get involved and do something huge for God. You know why? Nobody else is thinking about your life but you. Nobody else is meditating on your life but you. Nobody wakes up every day thinking how they can make you happy. So you need to focus on how to. You know why she wears hats? Hats make you feel good, don't they? Say it again.
Oh, yeah.
Say it again.
Oh, yeah.
Say it again.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, her. See, she has found what inspires her. She got more inspired than where she said it, didn't she? Well, Brother Mike, I don't wear hats. We didn't ask you to. I'm just telling you, you need to find what inspires you. How many found out when your house is in order, you get excited about living again? Don't you get excited about living again? Would you stand? There's two parts of the gospel that I emphasize repeatedly. The person of Jesus and his principles. One's the law of God, one's the life of God. One's the king, one's the kingdom. The person of Jesus prepares you for eternity. The principles of Jesus prepare you for the earth. You can be ready for heaven, but you can't buy a car because you don't understand the laws of increase, the law of focus, the law of faith. In the 72 laws that I mentioned in our school of wisdom, there's the law of protocol, there's the law of focus, there's the law of reproduction. There's the law, but today I want to talk to you about the law of difference. The law of difference. There's a difference in flowers. There's a difference in trees. There's a difference in nationalities and cultures. God is the creator of difference. Now we know that wisdom is the discovery of difference or the recognition of difference. Difference in a countenance, like Joshua or Joseph, when he saw the countenance of the butler and the baker. And he knew they had a problem. He saw and reacted to their difference. The Pharisees did not recognize nor celebrate the difference in Jesus, but Zacchaeus did. Jesus hung between two thieves. One cursed him, but the other one celebrated his difference and said, "Would you remember me? Today you'll be with me in paradise." There was a school of prophets in the Old Testament. But one of them, Elisha, had a difference in his passion. One theologian told me that he actually served Elijah, his mentor, for 22 years. I have not gone into the study of that, but I was stunned that he actually washed his feet for him, washed his clothes and traveled. Why? He saw Elijah's difference. And when Elijah was taken up in the whirlwind, the chariot, remember? It was Elisha who received the double portion. And in scripture, Elisha had exactly twice as many miracles as Elijah had in his life. Boaz saw the difference in Ruth. The king saw the difference in Esther. The king saw the difference in Daniel. Pharaoh saw the difference in Joseph. And in 24 hours went from the prison to being the number two prime minister man all over Egypt. The law of difference. It's important for you to see the difference in others. It's kind of foolish to try to teach a cat to bark because you've got to find the difference in everything around you. Why am I talking to you about this? Most people live a lifetime studying their weakness instead of their difference. Your difference reveals your assignment. Turtles don't talk, trees don't fly. I know the Bible talks about the sound of the turtle dove, but there is a different function for everything. My eyes don't talk, my mouth doesn't hear, my ear doesn't speak. Everything created has a different function. Have you discovered your divine difference? First, let's talk about God's difference from everything else and everybody else. Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie. God's major difference from humans, he never lies. He is a covenant God. Hath he not spoken it, will he not do it. God's difference in his character, his difference in his integrity, the difference in his power. I love what he told Job. When Job got a little cocky and said, if I could find God, I would argue with him. As long as that was his attitude, he couldn't find God. Finally, God said, where were you when I decided to create stars? Where were you when I decided to fling the stars into space and put planets and oceans? Where were you? Because God knew his difference. But you need to know God's difference from others. He's a faithful God. He's a caring God. He's a merciful God. And he's a God with profound expectations. But what is your difference? There are four things I want to bring your attention to. What do you love? What do you love to learn about? What do you love to hear about? What excites you? What energizes you? Number two, what environment do you flourish? In what kind of environment do you flourish? Even Jesus didn't do well in Nazareth. That's why he went to Capernaum. Places matter. Fish that die on the land thrive in the ocean. In what environment does your best come alive? Number three, what do you hate? What makes you mad? Anger is passion. Anger is energy. It just needs the appropriate focus. When Moses saw an Egyptian beating up on an Israelite, an anger rose on him. Is it molested children? Is it battered wives? What makes you mad? Drug addiction? I was watching a movie a few days ago where a man was so angry because his child had, been killed through a drug dealer selling him dope. And he was so angry. MADD, Mothers Against Drunken Drivers, drunk driving. That mother who started that organization saw her baby splattered on a pavement, killed because of a drunk driver. That's why she birthed that organization. Your anger is the birthplace for a change and for what makes you cry. What makes you weep? Pay attention to your sadness. Don't try to run away from sadness. Identify the cause of it. It may be something God wants you to heal. God wants you to change. This is my incredible gift of celebrating your seed of $58. Thank you for standing with my ministry. In the 58th chapter of Isaiah, he offers four rewards. So when you plant your seed on button 8, ask for the law of difference, how it can help you succeed, and expect your harvest.
This is another 2-Minute Wisdom Key with Dr. Mike Murdock.
Wisdom Key 6 was the key that changed my ministry, my life forever. What you make happen for others, God will make happen for you. What you make happen for others, God will make happen for you. Ephesians 6, 8. Day 5, on a 5-day fast, 2:30 a.m., I was in my garage, 11514 Eagle View Lane, Houston, Texas. And suddenly, a voice within me said, what you make happen for others, I will make happen for you. I disregarded the voice because I thought the Holy Spirit was reminding me of the golden rule. My mother had said, if you'll treat somebody else right, they will always treat you right. And then I thought, that's not true. I've treated people right and they treated me like a dog. Jesus never did say that. Jesus said, do unto others as you would that men would do unto you. He didn't say they would. He said, treat someone exactly like you want to be treated. Then he picks it up through Paul's writings, knowing that any good thing, Ephesians 6, 8, that you do for another person, the same you will receive from the Lord. In 8 weeks, my ministry support and mail jumped 20 times. My life forever changed. This became my life motto. It's my motto from this day forward. It has been for all those years. What I make happen for others, God will reproduce in my life. I never do something for somebody else so they'll do it for me. What I sow into others, I expect to reap from the hand of God. I may sow west, but He blesses me from the east. Every day of your life, concentrate on the success of others around you and watch God miraculously bless you.
This is another 2-Minute Wisdom Key with Dr. Mike Murdock.
Have you ever noticed in my book, 1001 Wisdom Keys, Wisdom Key 83, God never responds to pain, but He always responds to pursuit. I have had some people contest that and said, don't you say that God's touched with the feelings of infirmities. I said, yes, but He doesn't do anything about it. How do we know that? 5 feet from the hem of the garment of Jesus, the woman who had hemorrhaged for 12 years received no attention. 4 feet away, no attention. 3 feet away, no attention. 2 feet away, no attention. 1 foot away, no attention. But when she touched the hem of His garment, He said, something happened. Who touched me? He said, I perceive that virtue hath left me. They said, God, His disciples said, there's a lot of people around you that's touched you. He said, no, somebody touched me with a purpose. What happened? She pursued Him. You have no right to anything you haven't pursued. The qualification for receiving is asking. Matthew 7, 7, ASK, ask, seek, knock. Ask, seek, knock. Ask, seek, knock. Pursuit reveals passion. Reaching reveals trust. The blind man cries out, Jesus, Thou Son of David, have mercy on me. Nothing happened until he cried out. Zacchaeus climbed into the tree. Jesus said, can I go home with you? Wow. Isn't that amazing? You can hurt all day and nothing happens. You can cry all night and nothing happens. Tears don't attract God. Pain doesn't attract God. Why did God let this happen? You got to reach. You got to reach. You have not because you ask not. When you ask amiss. It's the difference between your success and your failure. Reaching.